I hope you find the next 20 minutes or so quite useful, and it brings up some interesting questions. So yeah, my name's Steph, and I'm an environmental advisor for J. Murphy & Sons, which is a construction contractor. And the division that I work in is specifically in railway repairs, but I'll come on to that a little bit later on. So I was thinking about when I was your age, and I was in year 10 and year 11, I'd obviously picked my options, and I'll be totally honest, I had no clue what I wanted to do. I think I had like this route that I wanted to be a teacher, but I just still didn't know what I wanted to teach. I thought it could possibly be PA or geography, but that's about as far as the thinking had gone. So I'd done my options, I went to sixth form, and I'd done performing arts because it was one of my hobbies. I just didn't really know what to do. And then I ended up studying music at uni as well. So a million miles away from where I am right now. So when I did graduate, I went away for a summer, I'd done a little bit of work, came back home, and I was like, right, now I need to make a decision. You know, I've had a bit of fun doing what I wanted to do. But you know, now it's time to like think about a career, which I'd not really thought about until that point. I just thought I was going to be a teacher and it would just happen overnight. So a friend was working somewhere and they had a temporary position for like 3 or 4 months, and it's doing really basic sort of like data collection, data entry for the carbon footprint of a product that they made at their factory. And I've always been quite green and quite into sort of environmental issues, and I thought that's really interesting. You know, that's something I can get behind. It's quite new at the time. And I thought that's a nice little challenge, and it'll give me a bit of time to decide what I actually want to do, because that wasn't it at the time. So the tool that they were using was quite new and it was always broken. So I was often sat there at the desk, like with nothing to do. And I was working at this big, massive factory with a huge warehouse. They were shipping products all over the world. So I just started to like get myself busy, just keep myself entertained. And I started introducing aspects of recycling and saving energy and just getting sort of like a bit of a flow with environmental things, just purely out of keeping myself entertained. And then the job extended a little bit longer. And I thought, well, I'm still getting to do a bit of performing arts, a bit of music, a bit of teaching on the side. You know, I was doing that at the weekends and in the evening. So I thought I could do the two things. And then after a while, they said, did I want the job permanently? And I was quite shocked because I thought, this isn't what I want to do. You know, what do I do? I'll be trapped here forever. What am I going to do? But I thought, you know what, just give it a go. If it doesn't work out, you know, I can just move on. And I'm still doing all these other hobbies, and I still had all these other connections to what I'd studied doing. And then after too long, they said, did I want to do a master's in environmental management? And I thought, that is impossible. Like, there's no way I can do that. You know, I've come from an arts background, and then jump into a science master's is just, it's going to be too difficult for me. But I applied anyway, I got on the course, and I struggled through it. I'll be honest, it was tough. It was really, really hard. I was working full time and doing the master's as well. But I done it, got through it, and I learned so much whilst doing it. Made loads of connections, loads of friends, and some of the people I studied with are doing absolutely insane things all over the world now. After about 9 years there, I think I'd done the master's after about two or three years. And it took like another 2 or 3 years to do because I was doing it part-time. I got made redundant and I was absolutely devastated because I thought, I don't know what to do. You know, I don't know where to go from here. Like, this is all I've ever known. They've supported me through all my studies and everything I've learned has been here. And I was just really worried about what I was going to do. And I thought, right, I'll go back to being a teacher. But I thought, hang on, that's ridiculous. I've learned all these skills. You know, and I've got this master's, like, what can I do with it? So I started looking around and I thought, right, I haven't had an interview for years. I don't know what to do. And when I was looking at interview skills and, you know, just bits and bobs, just trying to build up my confidence, I saw a really interesting statistic that stood out. And it was, I can't remember the exact statistic, but it was something along the lines of when a male reads a job description, if they think they can do 50%, that they'll apply for the job. But then in women, it was more towards 90-95%. They had to know that I could do 95%. And I thought, well, I don't have to do that. You know, let's just look wider and see what I can do. And I ended up at a construction consultancy. I just went for it. I thought, I've not got any experience, but I'll just go for it. Even if I just have the interview experience, it'll help. And I got it after one interview. So straight away, I was in another job, completely different industry, you know, and I thought, wow, I've done it. Like, I never thought I'd be able to make that big leap. But turns out I really hated it. consultancy wasn't for me. It was very sort of lots of report writing. It was a very, very sort of, it was a huge international company, very corporate. And I was used to working at the factory, being in the warehouse, you know, sorting through cardboard boxes to recycle and, you know, all this sort of up in the engine room, looking at energy consumption. And all of a sudden I was just sat at a desk every single day, all day. And it wasn't for me. So I thought, right, I want to get out there. I want to do something more environmental. So I essentially ran off to the Scottish Highlands with a tree planting company, really small group of people. There was like 10 or 15 of us. We were split over the Scottish Highlands and the west coast of Ireland on a project to plant a million trees by hand in the winter. It was tough. It was really incredible. But again, that wasn't for me. That was too far in the other direction. So that lasted about 3 months. The job of the consultancy lasted about 6 months. That was about 3 months. And then I came home and I saw like a temporary position at a waste recycling company near me. And they were just looking for somebody for just a couple of months. So I sort of set myself that target of sorting myself out by the end of that contract. You know, I had like 3 or 4 months and I thought, that's my aim. You know, I need to have something I'm going to stay at, because, you know, friends and family and stuff were starting to comment like, you've had so many jobs, you don't think it's going to look terrible on your CV. You know, you've moved around so much lately. And I thought, well, no, because it's really helped me find what I do like and what I don't like. And it's sort of narrowed down what I want to do. And it's given me so much experience, even though I didn't particularly enjoy either of those roles. It gave me so much experience at different things. And I'd obviously got, you know, a lot older. I'd sort of, you know, came into myself a little bit more. So going back to that thought process of, right, I can apply for anything that I can do at least half of on the job description. That was sort of my benchmark. And I saw the role that I'm doing now, which was an environmental advisor in the railway construction industry. And I thought, well, I've never, you know, I've got that 6 months of construction consultancy on my CV, but, you know, I don't know anything about construction, because this was just writing reports about projects that were going to happen in the future. And this role is being there when the job is on the ground. So again, just going back to that 50% thing, I thought, well, I'll just go for it. And I went for the interview and it went terrible, because they started asking loads of technical questions about being on site on construction, and I'd never been there. And they knew I'd never been there because it was on my CV that way. And I thought, well, that went dreadful. You know, maybe I should go back to that needing to do 90% of the job description before I apply next time. But then they invited me back for a second interview. Yeah, I realised that they were sort of looking for the right sort of personality, the right sort of fit for the team, because, you know, anything sort of technical you can learn if you've got the basic skills, you know, of a degree or anything, you know, in the industry sort of similar, you can learn so much, you know, and don't ever underestimate what you can switch to and what you can and can't learn, because, you know, I never thought I'd do this job ever. So a little bit about a day in the life of my sort of role. It's literally, I know a lot of people must say this, but it's so different every single day, because I can be working on 6, 7, 8 projects at once. Some of those are on the ground already. Some of those are being prepared for in the future. I get to go outside a lot, do a lot of walkouts. You know, we go to really obscure places. We have to hike across a big field before we get to a bridge or, you know, a train station, and do all our assessments, work with ecologists, and work with the engineers, work with the designers. Work with all the guys on the site. You know, we have to sort of put in a lot of like procedures for protecting endangered species. You know, there's lots of checks to do if it's nest and bird season, and there's lots of sort of conditions if we're going to be working near a watercourse, because obviously we're working with big machinery which has got fuel. So there's all lots of, every single job is different depending on what sort of environmental constraints are in the area. So yeah, it's really different. And we're not focusing a lot, but you know, it's obviously a very male dominated industry. And I think there's a little under 20% of a female workforce. But the female workforce are represented in every single role. You know, they are project managers, they're engineers, they're quantity surveyors, they're safety advisors, they're environmental advisors like myself. So although there are far less of us, we are well represented across the business in all sort of positions and, you know, types of roles. And a lot of people always ask, oh, what's it like to work in construction as a female? It must be really tough. And there are elements of it that are you know, difficult. But generally, it's, you don't really notice it, because it's not like they've never seen a woman before. You know, they've all got sisters, mums, partners, you know, it's fine. It really doesn't make that much of a difference. You know, and there's obviously a different dynamic that a female can bring to a heavily male environment, because they often get very hot-headed when things don't go very well. But if you're around, they can sometimes, you know, they're worried about their language, or, you know, they sort of ask for advice sometimes. So it's nice to sort of, you know, they sort of come to you sometimes, and it's just nice to feel like you are representing the female population as well. So yeah, that is roughly my sort of journey, how I've ended up where I am today, and a little bit about the role. So I hope that's give you a bit of an insight that you really don't have to make any decisions set in stone right now. And I would just recommend taking any opportunity that comes your way, and don't be afraid to sort of divert from anything that isn't on your plan. And it's great to have a plan if you've got one, because some people are really sort of driven and organized and career driven and know what they want to do. But I was not that person. And it's okay to be either, because you'll end up in something that you love eventually anyway.
Great, so Stephanie. Thank questions. You. So yeah, we could go to questions. So yeah. I've just got one. Can you just remind me? I'm sorry, I must have missed it. What masters did you say that you did?
Oh, I don't think I did. I'd done environmental management.
Environmental management.
So it was, it could be applied to any industry, basically. It wasn't specific for manufacturing or construction or anything. So.
Right, okay, lovely, thank you. Right, if I just go to the forms and we'll see. I'll come first perhaps to 10C, because I think they had a couple of questions that I know that they sent me, and then we'll just go A, B, D, E, F. So, Miss McQuillan, is there anyone there who might be able to ask the questions that you had? Right, in case you can't hear me, I've got them, so I'll ask them for you. So this came from Ted C. How have your hobbies, you know, like sport, etc., affected your mentality at work, your mental health at work? Their mic doesn't work. 10C's mic's not working. Sorry, yeah, go ahead.
So I think there's obviously like a physical aspect. You know, there's lots of sort of trudging through muds, walking through fields, climbing over bridges. So there's that aspect. But then there's so much teamwork needed. You've got to work with different teams all of the time. You've got to be flexible. You've got to know when to step back. You've got to know when to lead. And I think doing a lot of sport and being in sports teams when I was younger sort of gave me that ability to know when it's my, you know, it's my turn to step up or lead. And then it's absolutely great for foraging, because I'm always outside. I get to, that's one of my other hobbies. I think I wrote down on the bio, because I'm outside a lot. It's great for foraging. I can't always collect stuff, but yeah.
It's great.
I hope that answers that question.
Lovely, thank you. Yes. And another question is, how much of the waste that's produced in the construction company is actually recyclable?
It's a good question. So the sector that I work in, we work specifically for Network Rail. There are only clients in my business unit, and we have a performance target with them that 100% of the waste is diverted from landfill. So it's really ambitious, and as you can imagine, it's quite difficult when we're digging up bridges and then we find stuff that we weren't expecting. So there's a lot of segregation on the project. So way before the project starts, myself and the project manager and the site manager will sit down and we'll do something called a waste forecast for the project, and sort of estimate the volumes of concrete, stone, rubble, soil, wood, all these sort of things that we're going to be producing, and we make sure that we've got all the sort of right you know, skips and different things to store it all in way ahead of time. So, you know, we've got no sort of surprises, but we do always come across things that we're not sure of. But we work with some huge waste brokers that are sort of on standby, that if we do discover anything, they'll go out to the marketplace and find a route for it to help us commit to that 100% diversion from landfill. So I think, in general, most projects are 100% diverted from landfill. It doesn't necessarily mean everything gets recycled. Some of it gets reused. So for example, when we take off the stone on the railway, which was called ballast, we might reuse that somewhere else on another project. But yeah, so it's actually more than you'd probably think.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Yeah, they learn about that in chemistry, actually, because they learn that you might be making a useful product, but the second product might be not useful. But if you can sell it off to somebody, then you've achieved it, you know, near 100% atom economy. So that's the aim of it. Yeah. Okay, so more great questions coming in. They've asked, what makes your job more interesting now than the jobs you had before?
I think the variety that it brings. So as I say, I can work on like 6, 7, 8 projects at a time, and they're all completely different, and they're all in completely different locations. So I've got one coming up which is right in the middle of Stockport. It's going to be so busy, and then I've got others that are like way out in the countryside, and there's no houses or anything for ages, you know. So it's the variety that brings, and the balance of working at a desk writing reports, and yeah, as I say, getting out there, seeing the job, getting, you know, get finished, doing stuff like this. You know, there's so much variety, and in those other jobs I wasn't aware that I needed that variety and balance, so yeah, that's why I prefer this one the most.
Great. Right, so we're at time, but there was just some of the forms aren't able to unmic and ask you, but there was an interest in your plants behind you. There's one form. Could you tell us a little bit about the plants?
Yeah,
we've both got one more minute.
They're both called devil's ivy, and they're really easy to grow, so don't be too impressed.
Okay. So you brought the outside in, Stephanie. That's nice. Well, thank you so much for giving us a bit of an insight. It sounds like you've got an absolutely very varied job, which sounds really, really interesting, and we could talk, as always with these things, so much more, but thank you for that insight. And as I say, if any of the pupils are sparked by an interest, then you know, we'll certainly come back to you if that's okay. Lovely. Okay. Many thanks.
Thanks everyone.
From the forum. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Oh, thank you, Stephanie. That was so interesting.
No problem.
Every time we do these, though, do you not feel, Miss Taishma? You always feel like, oh God, my job. I could have all these different things you could be doing.
Yes, because you've made construction sound, you know, exciting, and we don't always think about. I don't always think about it like that, but certainly from the waste thing, the 100%, not going to landfill. That's amazing.
Yeah, I think everyone thinks to work in construction you've got to have an engineering degree, and it's not the case.
Yeah, I think that showed the girls that as well. I mean, to go from doing music and drama to then a complete flip, and like I think what you said about, you know, you don't have to know everything to have a go at something. You're looking for the right kind of person and the right attitude. That's really good for them to know. I hope they remember that, because some of them do think they have to be perfect at something to apply for it, and that can be the same in school as well, to have a go at something. I think they've got to know it all, but actually that isn't the case.
Yeah, it was such an eye opener when I read that. Actually, it gave me so much confidence.
Yeah,
disregarded so many other roles because I just thought, well, I can't do most of that, so
oh, that was brilliant. I must go because I've got a lesson, but
no worries. Okay.
Thank you, so I'll leave you with Emma, but thank you so much.
No problem. Thanks,
I hope to see you again. Bye-bye.
Thanks Steph.
Thanks Emma, no worries, see you soon.
If I get anything from them, I'll definitely reach out.
If they've got any other questions, just send them over. I could just email them over or whatever. Well, yeah, you've got Josh's contact details for the other one, haven't you?
Yeah, ready for the next one. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah,
all right, then. All right, great.
Thank you, Emma. Take care.
Bye. Bye.